A very good afternoon, Ambassador Gopinath, Pillai, Chairman of Institute of South Asian Studies, and Ambassador at Large, Ministry of Foreign Affairs. Mrs. Chandrika B, Kumaratunga, Chairperson, Office for National Unity and Reconciliation, Sri Lanka, and former President of Sri Lanka, distinguished panelists, esteemed guests, and ladies and gentlemen. My name is Aisha Vijayalal, and I have the pleasure to be your MC today. Welcome to this afternoon's ISAS public lecture on Terrorism and the State, Transforming Conflict, Building Peace, to be delivered by Mrs. Kumaratunga. It is now my pleasure to invite Ambassador Gopinath Pillai to give the opening remarks. Ambassador Pillai, please.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you for being here. Mrs. Kumaratunga, former President of Sri Lanka, High Commissioner for Sri Lanka to Singapore, Mr. Veerawardene, the three scholars who are actually panel members, Professor Muni, Professor Vinita Sinha, and Professor Riaz Hasan. Ladies and gentlemen, on behalf of ISAS, I welcome you to this special program that we have put together to hear a very distinguished speaker. Prevention of terrorism and countering extremism has become a major challenge for most of the countries in the world. Terrorism is an extreme form of dissent, and this is, to me, both immoral and self-defeating, especially as it often results in the loss of innocent civilian lives and the process sacrifices the long-term well-being of the community that the group professes to support and to raise. There are no countries in the world that have benefited from terrorism, even though there are countries that sometimes support the terrorism. Sri Lanka has had tremendous suffering because of the violence in the country. Some may say it was not terrorism, but international community has branded it as terrorism. Needless to say, the conflict in Sri Lanka has caused great embarrassment to the country. It has caused great disaster to the economy. It has set the country back several decades. A country that was poised to be the star of South Asia. If you go back to just after Second World War, Sri Lanka had more PhDs in terms of its population than any other Asian country. And Singapore was at one time a close second to Sri Lanka in many years. But that all changed because of the conflict. With the military aspect of the conflict over and normalcy returning to almost all parts of Sri Lanka, the country is looking to build peace, much work in terms of post-war reconstruction, rehabilitation and development has been achieved, while much more remains to be done. As internationalized conflict, there have been several UN human rights resolutions on Sri Lanka, and some of them led by the United States since the war ended. There's one, the last one was 2015, which is co-sponsored by Sri Lanka. In regard to the said national reconciliation and prevention of future conflict future conflict will come by addressing grievances and needs of those directly affected by the war, as well as adopting a system, a government system, that is fair to all. We are indeed fortunate to have Mrs. Chandrika Kumaratunga with us today to speak on terrorism and the state, transforming conflict, building peace. Mrs. Vandara Naike Kumaratunga served as the President of Sri Lanka from 1994 to 2005. Mrs. Kumaratunga has a degree in political science from the University of Paris, among other educational qualifications. She was born into a very privileged family, and with many family, very distinguished family members. But the most distinguished, of course, her father, SWRT Bandanaike, and Mrs. Hima Bandanaike, was the first woman head of government in the world. Her father's name is always etched in my mind for two reasons. One is, I remember as a student reading the New Statesman. Most of you would not have heard of New Statesman. It's a magazine that is left-leaning, a socialist magazine. It reported when Mr. Bandanaike became Prime Minister that when he was studying, not sure whether Oxford or Cambridge, Anthony Eden, who subsequently became Prime Minister of Britain, for a short while, his term was shortened officially for health reasons, but really because he made a mess of the Suez Canal situation. He was supposed to have said to one of his friends, pointing to Mr. Bandanaike, that there goes the future Prime Minister of Sri Lanka. That's the first thing I remember, and I remember it always. Second was his full name. He was SWRD Bandanaike. As a student, I participated in a general quiz, and a question was posed, what is the full name of the Prime Minister of Sri Lanka? I was very happy that I was the only one who knew what SWRD stands for. Solomon West Ridgway Dias Bandanaike. I was very proud of that. So it's never left my mind. So Mrs. Kumaratunga, very happy to see you for many, many reasons. Most of all, because I think you are known to be a very cerebral person and speak extremely well. So we are looking forward to that speech. I want to now thank the panelists, the three panelists that we have. This is Mr. Riaz Hassan, who's from Melbourne, and he was with ISAS. He's still a visiting member of ISAS. Professor Vinita Sinha, she's head of the South Asian Studies at the National University of Singapore, who is our parent body, NUS. Then Professor Muni. Professor Muni used to be with us. He's now sort of semi-retirement. I really need to thank him because he is the one who actually persuaded Mrs. Kumaratunga to come and speak to us. And he is the man who admires Mrs. Kumaratunga very much, and I usually admire those he admires because he's generally quite right, and he's been very helpful in many ways for the growth of ISAS. Ladies and gentlemen, I think you will have a very good session, a speech followed by a panel discussion. One unrelated, in some ways related, subject that I want to mention to you is that in July, mid-July, July 18th and 19th, we are going to have the third South Asian Diaspora Convention. this would be a much bigger program than in the last few years. And the chief guest for the event is the Prime Minister of Sri Lanka, Mr. Ranil Wickremesinghe. This will be on the 18th. Next day we will have several other programs. The highlight of the first evening is a gala dinner where our own Prime Minister will be the guest of honor, and he will conduct a dialogue with a very seasoned diplomat from India, who was Foreign Secretary of India, Shyam Sarai. We hope you look at it, look at the program, see whether it is good, and try and come to this program. Ladies and gentlemen, thank you for coming. Jack, thank you for spending the time. ISAS does many, many programs in India, and we hope you participate. And today's program will not disappoint you, I'm certain. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Ambassador Pillai. Ladies and gentlemen, I would now like to invite Mrs. Kumaratunga on stage to address us.
Ambassador Gopinath, Pillai, Professor Lee, Professor Sinha, Hassan, Mitra, Excellencies, friends. I would first like to thank the Institute of South Asian Studies of the National University of Singapore, and especially Ambassador Pillai, for giving me this opportunity to talk to you today and be among you, and also get to know better the distinguished institution which is the National University of Singapore. I would like to talk today on the state and terrorism, transforming conflict, building peace. I believe this is a subject that has been talked about till the cows come home, especially in the last few decades. Yet I would like to place before you some of my thoughts about it. Coming from a country which has been a victim of terrorism, of violent conflict, and also being a person who has personally suffered the consequences of this. We know that terrorism poses the most serious political and military challenge to modern states. It is no more contained within the boundaries of one state. It has an extensive global outreach. Terrorist organizations born in one country have the capacity to attack the furthest lands. The most militarized states have not been impervious to the activities of the terrorist. The international community, and especially the superpowers, have been engaged for the past few decades in searching for solutions to the problem of terrorism and violent conflict. The strategies often employed are mainly military. The responses of states appear to be that of meeting the challenges of violence with violence, treating the symptoms, the surface manifestations of the problem. Recognizing the importance of searching out the deep-rooted causes of conflict, and seeking to resolve them seems to be a rare occurrence in the planning of counter-terrorist strategies. We can witness all around us the dismal failure of mainly militarist methods to address violent conflict. I believe that military strategies must be employed only as the solution of the last resort. The deep-rooted causes of each conflict must be understood and managed. This will, no doubt, take time and involve complex operations. However, it is such a holistic approach that has proved to finally overcome violent protest and conflict in a durable manner. The state has a special responsibility, I need hardly say, to engage with commitment in a process of conflict transformation. In the post-colonial and especially the post-Cold War era, the subject of conflict has moved from territorial or land issues to that of identity, as defined by race, language, religion, caste, and ideology. Identity-based conflicts are complex and prove difficult to manage as they are so emotionally charged, combining perceptions of inequality and discrimination in several spheres. The most potent source of violent conflict today is identity. The denial of rights to or the exclusion of certain groups with common identity becomes the bedrock of dissent and violent conflict. Perceptions of inequality arise firstly from the unequal treatment of different communities of citizens by the state, such as the denial of access to resources and public facilities, such as education, jobs, land, government positions, and so on. They are heightened by the realization or perception that one's identity, individual or collective, is threatened, generating the fear that one's existence, the sense of who one is in danger of destruction. Studies have amply demonstrated that exclusion and inequality between different groups has been the major cause of intra-national conflicts. When inequality occurs, among groups which have similar economic and social status, that is, horizontal inequalities as it is called, the disadvantaged groups feel the discrimination more sharply. Perceived injustice, as well as frustration and despair caused by continued social marginalization, economic deprivation, and political defeat, has been known to result in violence. It has been said that young hope betrayed transforms itself into bombs. The continued existence of inequality gives rise to violence and even terrorism, that most dehumanizing phenomenon of our times. Economic regression and political instability follow. I wish to affirm here that marginalized groups have been found to perceive injustice not only as economic deprivation, but also to see it through the prism of social and political inequality. The exclusion of some communities from an equitable share of the benefits of prosperity causes inequalities in every sphere. Economic development is no doubt the priority requirement for addressing the challenges of poverty and deprivation. We know that although most developing economies today have attained accelerated growth and development in the past few decades, hundreds of millions of our citizens have been left behind, continuing to live under conditions of extreme poverty and are even becoming poorer than before. They remain marginalized, while the benefits of economic growth are enjoyed by a relatively small number of the privileged classes. lack of access to education and knowledge, jobs, land and other public assets, as well as by an ever-increasing number of our peoples, causes frustration and anger. They are no more willing to tolerate the inequalities. Economic development happens to be only one part of the solution. We need to adopt a holistic plan of action, which will encompass the socio-political aspects of the problem. All those communities which have been excluded must be included as equal partners, having equal rights in the economic, social, and political spheres, in formulating policies for development. An inclusive approach is required so that the benefits of growth reach the disadvantaged and they are included in decision making and implementation of the programs. Studies have also ascertained that when all communities living within a state are guaranteed equal opportunities and their separate identities are respected and given free expression, they will become a productive, vibrant part of the state, celebrating the richness of its diversity while building a united, strong and stable country. Such a society is called a cohesive or shared or inclusive society. It is a society where the political, governmental and societal structures are designed to allow the equitable distribution of and equal access to the benefits of development and prosperity for all, irrespective of the community to which they belong. The constitution of the state, its political structures such as parliament and other elected bodies, its government and administrative structures will all have to be constructed in a manner as to accommodate free and active participation of all in political and governmental processes, as well as the guarantee of equal rights to all. The contrary instance is where differences among diverse communities living within the country have been exacerbated by rulers to their advantage. They tend to conjure up an enemy from peoples who belong to different ethnic, religious, caste, or political groups. History is replete with examples of states and governments employing the concept of the other, represented as the enemy, as a tool of government management. For a large part of human history, the concept of the enemy has been used to forge national unity, as well as entrench weak rulers and governments in power. Governments whip up hatred against the other by maintaining the myth of the dichotomy between us and them. This requires the oppression of the other and the denial of their rights. Such exclusion takes place not only through outright hostility, but also through neglect of minority groups. Sustainable development, prosperity and peace necessarily imply that the other be brought in and included fully and honestly into the processes of economic development and as full and equal partners of the process of government. To power sharing, for instance, to end poverty and hunger in a durable manner, we need inclusive and sustainable development. Here I wish to quote from the great Indian poet and philosopher Rabindranath Tagore, who said, I quote, "Bigotry tries to keep truth safe in its hands with a grip that kills it." Close quote. Stuart and Brown, in an Oxford University study, affirm that cultural, economic, political inequalities occurring between specific groups cause deep resentment, resulting in violent struggles. Violence in multi-religious and multi-ethnic nations is not caused by the presence of diversity or by the clash of civilizations, as stated by Huntingdon, for example, but is due to the exclusion of the less powerful groups. The marginalized groups then mobilize around their group identity. Professor Rehman Soman affirms in his work on poverty and injustice that poverty, injustice, and their relationship to conflict may be measured by the difference in opportunity structures for the excluded. Horizontal inequalities between communities of equal social and cultural status has proved to have engendered a remarkable number of conflicts. I'd like to give some examples briefly. Economic and social inequalities have been found to cause a significant increase in the probability of conflict, increasing threefold when they occur horizontally between different ethnic groups of equal status. Indonesia, the Moro rebellion in the Philippines, and the Maoist uprisings in Nepal are examples of conflicts arising from economic and social deprivation of some communities. Then there is also inequality in the cultural sphere that has led to violence and terrorism. For example, language discrimination in Peru and Guatemala, and also in my country, Sri Lanka. Also, racial and religious discrimination in Malaysia, Ivory Coast, Northern Ireland, and Palestine. Then there is political inequality, which has also proved to be a major cause of conflict. Nigeria, Ghana, Kenya, Bolivia, Malaysia, and India have managed to contain conflict by effecting political inclusion through power sharing in their countries. In Sri Lanka, economic and social inequalities, together with language discrimination, gave rise to an armed conflict waged by the Tamil minority community. Although now, Peru and Sri Lanka have militarily crushed their rebellions, the causes of conflict have yet to be resolved. It is important to understand that conflict is not always a negative thing. It is the result of interaction between different and opposing aspirations and goals, and is a place where disputes are processed. Conflict is essential for the proper functioning of democracy. It can mobilize energies for social change and improvement. However, conflict becomes negative and destructive when its expression takes a violent form. Democratic governments permit disputes to be expressed and respond to them. Democracy can operate as a platform for conflict management if the right tools are employed. What is required is not to suppress conflict, but to manage them. The root causes must be alleviated. At this point, it would be pertinent for me to raise a very current issue, the issue of militant Islamism and its ideology. We are aware that global Islamism, as opposed to Islam, is very different to Islam. Islam is a religion of the Muslim peoples, while Islamism is a political ideology. The chief ideologue of the global Islamist movement, let us say one of the initial ones, Osama bin Laden, made many statements presenting the major causes of their militantism to justify his call for Muslims to take up arms against the so-called infidel. The first reason he advanced was the presence of non-Muslim infidel troops on Hijaz land. The leaders of Islam, he said, found it intolerable that the powerful caliphates of yesteryear, of the period of the Ottoman Empire, had declined to the point where the caliphates were abolished by the Western colonial occupiers and the Holy Lands occupied by Western troops. The second reason that was given was the non-resolution of the Israel-Palestinian problem and the occupation of Palestinian lands by Jewish troops. These formed the basis for Bin Laden's complaint of a so-called crisis for all Muslims. He saw it as a problem not only for one country, but a crisis for the Ummah itself. Thus was fashioned the global Islamist movement. The enemy was not a national entity, but the Western infidel forces that were said to be violating not only the holy lands of Jerusalem, but also the Hijaz itself. At the same time, a cult movement for Muslims to adhere closely to a specific lifestyle was put in place. A political Islamist movement was created in individual Muslim countries whose governments were pressurized to adopt Sharia. The Islamist concept is an account of the Muslim predicament during the last century or so. In his excellent treatise on Islamism, Lord Meghnad Desai states that Islamist ideology, I quote, appeals to a deep hurt in the Muslim psyche, and it is this hurt we need to understand. But we need to mount a critique of the ideology since its presumptions are false in many ways, and its recipe for assuaging the hurt of the Muslims is counterproductive. In this context, an ideological army of youth fighting to free the Muslim world of the so-called Western enemy came to be born. The reach of the Islamist movement across the globe was certainly facilitated by the spread of modern communications technology and air travel. I need hardly describe to you the tragedies that have been caused by these movements today in the recent past, even if you look at the recent past, all over the world. At this point, permit me to describe my personal experiences as head of state of Sri Lanka. My government was committed to the concept that federalism and inclusivity were the solutions to Sri Lanka's minorities question. We had ascertained that the exclusivist majoritarian views were held by only a small minority of the population and that the masses, in their vast majority, were not committed to extremist political views of any type. We understood that we must negotiate with the minorities and their leaders and bring in suitable concessions, and that sharing what we possess with the others will not reduce our strength. Instead, it will enhance it by bringing together divided communities, working together, bringing in skills, talents, and knowledge of the marginalized that were deprived to us since the beginning of the conflict, and that their active participation in the nation-building process will immensely enrich and unify our divided nation. Hence, we adopted a strategy of honest public discourse to inform the people that the only viable solution was to choose the path of dialogue, negotiations, and peace achieved by means of sharing political power through a federal constitution and by building a cohesive nation and an inclusive state. I'm still talking of the two. Pre-2005 era, we won three major elections within 18 months with an increased majority vote at each one, talking frankly to the people about these concepts. A Gallup poll, you may be interested to know, that we conducted at the time my government first came to power in 1994 showed that only 23% of the single majority community opted for a negotiated settlement of the conflict. They all said war should be the solution. Then we undertook extensive programs to take the message of peace and shared societies to the country. We had seminars, workshops, street theater, and used the media widely. At the end of 2 years, another similar survey showed that the number of people opting not only for peace, but this time also for devolution of political power, had increased from 23% to 68% in 2 years. We just needed to talk to the people and tell them what was fact. The vision and actions of leaders of government have been instrumental in defining the choices made by the Sri Lankan people. For the first time in the history of independent Sri Lanka, my government offered a comprehensive solution to the minorities' problem. First, even while war had to be waged, we began and completed a large number of essential development projects in the north and east where the war was being conducted, and where infrastructure damage had been caused during many years of war. This no doubt created employment locally for the youth, who until then had seen no hope of a better future for themselves and were being persuaded or forced to join the rebel forces. Thus, we were able to demonstrate to the Tamil civilians that there could exist Sri Lankan governments with honest intentions of including the Tamils and all other citizens equitably in the development process. Empirical evidence showed that the numbers of youth joining the rebel armies were considerably reduced since we adopted these policies. However, we understood that economic development alone could not succeed in creating an inclusive society and durable peace. For this, it was required to share political power, which we, the Sinhalese majority, had jealously guarded to ourselves since independence, marginalizing all others, not only in practice, but also by law. Hence, we proposed to enact a new constitution containing extensive devolution of power to the minorities, together with various other measures adopted to guarantee their rights. In this draft constitution, I also proposed to completely abolish the executive presidency, which we thought accorded excessive powers to the president. We could not translate our dream of enacting this constitution and transforming a divided, violent country into a united nation where peace prevailed because of the consistent and violent rejection of our peace proposals by the LTTE, the Tamil Militant Group, as well as the obstinacy of the parliamentary opposition at the time in refusing to give the government the few votes required to make up the two-thirds majority in parliament. We understood that it would be difficult to achieve a sustainable peace by responding to the terrorist in his language of violence, which he controlled and employed more successfully than the state. The terrorist language of violence. However, if we employed the language of peace against the terrorist's language of violence, he would not possess the weapons in his arsenal of violence to respond successfully to our discourse and practice of peace. The terrorist can thus be disarmed morally and weakened. Hence, the infrastructure development in the war-affected areas, despite strong opposition from the terrorist groups, and our proposals for a new constitution embodying wide-ranging political power-sharing mechanisms. This began to yield positive results. The LTTE was compelled by the Tamil civilian population in the war zones to permit the government to continue development work. This caused a slow but definite whittling away of the terrorist argument that there existed no alternative to a separate state and terrorist politics, because for the first time the government of Sri Lanka demonstrated a clear willingness to accord the Tamil population their full rights. We saw the beginning of a change of attitudes among the Tamil population, with the Tamil youth beginning to move away from joining the rebel forces. All this led finally to successfully persuading the rebels to sign a landmark agreement for the first time with the government of Sri Lanka to work with the government in the process of reconstruction of the tsunami affected areas. Unfortunately, this too could not be prevented because I finished my presidency and my successor did not believe in this. Sri Lanka has today entered a new and interesting phase in its political history since January 2015. We now have a government of national unity and consensus, comprised of the two major opposing political parties in the country, together with several other parties. This government is working on a common vision and a common program to bring about good governance by means of strengthening democracy, democratic institutions, the guarantee of fundamental rights, media freedom, and the effective resolution of the minorities' question. We have an opportunity as never before to resolve the ethnic problem which has dogged our nation for 7 decades since independence and caused much destruction, economically, socially, culturally, and politically. The new government has committed itself to work towards reconciliation and peace. When it first came to power 1.5 years ago, it was faced with several major challenges. On one hand, there was the issue of war crimes, allegedly committed by the then government and the forces at the end of the war in 2009. This gave rise to serious disagreements between the previous government of Sri Lanka and the international community. 2 resolutions were passed against Sri Lanka at the Geneva Human Rights Council, with the government steadfastly refusing to engage in the process of justice for war victims and so on. On the other hand, another challenge we faced were the problems of missing persons, reparations, and building bridges for a durable peace through mutual understanding, coexistence, and building an inclusive nation. The government has launched various actions to resolve these diverse aspects of reconciliation. Government leaders, firstly, are speaking publicly of the need to resolve the minorities question as opposed to the language of hate and exclusion expressed by the previous regime. The historic situation which prevails of the 2 major political parties which had extremely conflictual relations for many decades, now uniting to govern together and employ the politics of consensus instead of conflict, has engendered a unique advantage of successfully employing solutions to resolve difficult problems. The executive president from one political party and the prime minister from the other have evolved practical systems of working harmoniously together in government. The political will of the government is positively driving the process of reconciliation, without which nothing would be possible. We strongly believe that to transform conflict to peace, a holistic approach englobing all the aspects I spoke of earlier must be employed. Institutions have been set up to handle the various issues. Diverse programs are being implemented to change the thinking and attitudes of different communities towards each other. One program is for children, another for adults living in the rural areas mainly. Still another will deal with people traumatized by war. There is also a program for women in the war-affected areas to empower them economically and also to protect themselves physically from various types of abuse, which is still said to prevail to some extent. The performing arts, sports, and religious festivals are utilized to take the message of reconciliation throughout the country. Stakeholder participation is encouraged at the decision-making and implementation levels in all the aforesaid reconciliation programs, with the government and civil society working closely together once again for the first time in our country's history. The whole nation is being awakened to a new future. A future where all Sri Lankans will live in harmony with equal rights within an inclusive society. In conclusion, I'd like to state that reconciliation happens in the hearts and minds of people. Then, and only then, could we build a lasting peace. Thank you. There is a little presentation which came a bit late. So I have to tell it again. Yes, this is just to describe to you very briefly the process of reconciliation undertaken by the government. There is resettlement and rehabilitation of people who have been displaced by war. Houses are needed for them. There are lands that were taken over, I think unnecessarily. Huge tracts of thousands of acres of land that were taken over by the military, supposedly for security reasons, are now being returned to the owners. Then there is the issue of truth, justice, accountability. We are in the process of formulating a truth-seeking process. We cannot just adopt truth commissions and truth-seeking processes that were employed, for example, by South Africa, because they believe they do not suit the South Asian ethos. So we are looking at everything that happened, but attempting to evolve something new. Then there is the justice and accountability mechanism for war crimes, for which we have to first ascertain, make a final list of the number of missing persons and who they are, and also ascertain whether those missing, whether we can identify the officers of the state, the authorities who made them go missing, who took them away. In some instances, the names are known. Then engage in a process of reparations, financial and otherwise, for those who have the victims of war. On both sides, on the Tamil side and as well as soldiers who have disappeared. Then there is also the issue of non-recurrence. Can we go to the next one? Non-recurrence, which is being handled by an institution called the Office for National Unity and Reconciliation, which I happen to head. You have the details of what I described. The truth, justice, accountability processes are being coordinated by an institution called the Secretariat for Coordinating Reconciliation Mechanisms, which is responsible for setting up an office for missing persons, a separate office for reparations, the special courts for war crimes, and so on. The non-recurrence part is what I have to talk to you about. We conceptualize, design programs, and implement them, find the funding of course, and implement them with civil society organizations on one hand, and on the other, through government agencies where it is required. These are the main things I just mentioned in my point of view. We have just formulated a national policy for reconciliation, which will become the state policy for reconciliation, accepted and widely publicized, which we hope will become a permanent fixture in the country. Then I mentioned that we were doing programs for children. That is mainly school children of a certain age, even older children, many programs. the economic empowerment of the more affected communities, then language rights, though Sri Lanka has a law since 1957 for equal status for the Tamil language, together with the Sinhala language, it has never been implemented in practice. All governments have gone by default, not implementing it. So now we are taking action to force. Actually, we have to literally compel government departments and officers to do it, but it is happening. The psychosocial support structure is for war traumatized people, a bit complicated because we don't have sufficient number of experts to do it, but it has begun also. There's a conflict resolution programs for adults, which we have started in the villages, where groups of adults, professionals, teachers, also ensure that there are religious people from each of the four major religions in the group of 40, it's done in groups of 40, where they have one-day workshops, the objective of which is to transform their attitudes. Then arts and culture programs. Women for Reconciliation is a special program for women in the north and east, the war affected areas, which will also then spread to the south for the southern women who have suffered from war, and then a similar program for youth. That's what we are doing for the moment. Next. These are some pictorial evidence of some of the work. We celebrate one major religious festival of each religion, where we get the children of all four religions, Buddhist, Hindu, Muslim, Christian, celebrating, for example, the top one is Thai Pongal, the Hindu festival, which happens in January. The children of all religions celebrating together. On the left you have the Sinhala children, in the middle are the Tamil children dressed in their traditional way, on the right are the Muslim children, and the Christian children are also Sangalya, and they literally celebrate it together. They eat the specific food that is eaten at such a festival. They do the games, they observe the religious observances that are relevant to that particular one. So that's the one program we do. Next. That's what all we have for the moment. There are pictorial things of images of other programs we have just started, but that's not here. I'm sorry about that.